the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good evening, and welcome to the Bible class. It is such a privilege to do Bible class, and I'm grateful to God for it. As usual, it's Wednesday, and having prayed to the Holy Spirit, we are now ready for the Bible class. Today, we will study the last chapter, chapter 21 of the Gospel of John. In today's class, we will study the following: Jesus and the miraculous catch of fish. Number two, we will see why the apostles dare not ask Jesus, "Who are you?" And three, Jesus tests Peter and reinstates him as a leader. Before we start, we have come to the end of the toughest of the four Gospels, and we must thank God for it. Even though we are going on a three-month break, you will be able to watch all our previous videos. They will be found on this link anytime you wish to see any of them. And those of you familiar with YouTube, you know that you just have to type Sam's Bible Class in the search bar of YouTube and you will get my videos. So let's start reading chapter 21, a fascinating chapter: Jesus and the miraculous catch of fish. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way: Simon Peter, Thomas also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, that is John and James, and two other disciples were together. "I am going out to fish," Simon Peter told them, and they said, "We will go with you." So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Jesus had already appeared to his disciples twice thus far. You know, in that room, in that locked room in Jerusalem, once without Thomas and the other time with Thomas. Yeah. Yet human nature tends to forget. Peter and six other apostles were idling away without Jesus being constantly with them. You know, they were sitting on the beach. They were feeling empty. That's what happens to us when there is no Jesus in our lives. It's no wonder they went back to their old jobs, that is fishing, and did not succeed. See, they were experienced fishermen. They had toiled all night and must have been tired, exhausted, and totally disappointed because their toil had yielded absolutely nothing. They had tried everything and had been unable to catch even one fish. Naturally, their spirits must have been drooping. We'll read from verse 4. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some." See, again, Jesus appears early in the morning and it was dark. And add to that, Jesus addresses them as friends, something that he did not do earlier. Hence, the apostles did not realize that it was Jesus. Also, we will read in verse 8 of this chapter that the boat was still nearly 100 meters from shore, so they couldn't tell it was Jesus. But if the boat was that far away, how did they hear his voice? Surely he wasn't using a loudspeaker. Well, you must know that sound waves travel farther on the surface of a lake or sea than on land. I know. I have been a sailor. So, when they hear the stranger asking them, "Haven't you caught any fish?" they are too tired to reply. So they respond with a curt no. But when the stranger tells them to throw the net on the right side of the boat, it would seem that the stranger was trying to get to their nerves by trying to teach them how to fish. "You see, I don't know how to cook, you know. But whenever I try to advise my wife in the kitchen, it annoys her, so I don't try to invade her territory." You'll agree that unsolicited advice from non-professional strangers can be quite irritating. But this stranger has called them friends, so the apostles listen to his advice. I'll read from verse 6. He said, throw your net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some. When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. See what happens when you listen to advice with an open mind. Their catch was so heavy that they could not haul the net in. Verse 7. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. But how did John come to know that it was the Lord? There must have been some solid reasons why John came to this conclusion. Remember, he too could not see Jesus standing far away in the dark. There were two things by which John realized that it was in fact the Lord. See, the first reason. See, Jesus did not ask them, how many fish have you caught? But he asked them, haven't you caught any fish? As if he knew that there was no fish in the boat. How could anyone more than 100 meters away know that their boat was empty without any fish? Only Jesus would have known. And the second reason, see, they were expert fishermen, had toiled all night and failed to catch a single fish. So, the man who told them to cast their net on the right side of the boat must have been spot on. But what was astounding that listening to him had resulted in two miracles. First, to catch so many fish suddenly in a lake that seemed to have no fish that night was something miraculous. Secondly, the fact that the net was so heavy that they could not heave it up into the boat. It should have certainly torn with the weight of the fish. But it had not. That was another miracle. And no one but Jesus could perform such miracles. That is why John told Peter, it is the Lord. We'll read from verse 7 to 8. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. You know, throughout all the four Gospels, we have seen how impulsive Peter was. The moment he is told that it was Jesus, he just jumped into the water and swam across. You can see that they had to tow the net to shore. That is, they had to pull the net till they reached the shore. Thus, you can gauge how big was their catch, because they just could not lift up and haul the net into the boat. We read from verse 9 onwards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish you have just caught. So Simon climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many fish, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. Imagine how tired and hungry they might have been after working all night. Jesus was thoughtfully aware of that. No wonder he had already started a fire of burning coals with fish in it and some bread. That very sight must have soothed the apostles' hearts no end. Their breakfast was already being prepared without any effort on their part. They could just take a break and eat without any stress. But what is it about the 153 large fish that has fascinated all those who read this chapter? Many people theorize a lot of mathematical permutations from this number and create phantasmagorical stories around them. Do you think John intended all his readers to be mathematical geniuses? No. So please let us stick to the fact that by writing 153, John means that there was a very large number of fish in the net. But then you might ask as to why John mentions 153 large fish specifically. Well, it could have so happened that after Jesus left, they must have sat down to sort the fish to sell them and must have counted the 153 large ones and ignored the smaller tiny ones in their count. It's a natural human tendency, you say. When we have too much of something, for example money, we will not care about the pennies. Thus, they were not bothered about the anchovies and the other small fish. The total could have been 153, It was just that John remembered that miracle for a number of years and wrote it down in the gospel. Okay, you might argue that John has a habit of writing symbolic clues in the book of Revelation. Yes, he does. But remember, Revelations was all about messages written in code to the persecuted Christians of that age, because the Roman Empire was out to decimate them. So let us lay the theories around the number 153 to rest. It was just that they caught a large number of fish. For example, we already know that the number 40 is also used in the Bible to denote a large number and does not exactly mean 40. We'll go to verse 12. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. You see, in the last chapter, we had seen that the disciples had locked themselves for fear of the Jewish leaders, and yet Jesus appeared and stood among them. This shows that the risen Lord's physical makeup is not the same as it was before the crucifixion. As long as he lived, Jesus lived just like you and me. He lived, suffered, and died on that cross. He could have saved himself with the divine powers he had, but he didn't. Just like he didn't when he was tempted in the desert. But having finished living his life on earth and having conquered death, Jesus no longer is the same. He is the kernel of wheat that has fallen to the ground and died. He is risen in the body that is now new and now divine. We know that John will write something only if it has relevance. He says that they all knew it was the Lord. But if they did, why does John write this sentence? "Yet none of the disciples dared ask him, 'Who are you?'" If they all knew it was Jesus, why should they even think of confirming that it was Jesus? This is another indication that there was something unusual about the appearance of Jesus after his resurrection. Possibly it was a result of the beatings he had endured on the cross and the scars which remained, at least in part. Also, his facial features must have altered due to the crown of thorns. Those thorns were long. They must have penetrated his temples and his forehead and possibly pierced his eyebrows, giving him a puffed look. You know, those who have had the misfortune to visit a morgue to identify a close relative who has died, especially in an accident, will relate to what I am talking. It is so difficult to identify the body because of the injuries. I must confess that this verse is one of the most revealing verses that one can come across in this gospel. But it will reveal a lot only if we go back 2000 years to that beach on the Sea of Galilee and sit among that lot of seven apostles along with Jesus. It will reveal a lot only if we read between the lines and deduce what might have been going on in the minds of the apostles, especially John when he wrote this gospel. So let's come back to the question. If they all knew it was Jesus, why should they even think of confirming it, that it was Jesus? See, they were not sure it was Jesus because of his changed physical appearance. But they were absolutely sure it was Jesus by the miracles they had just seen him do. It was his appearance that boggled their senses. They could not understand, but they did not have the courage to ask. Also, let us put ourselves into the place of the apostles. Let us attempt to go into their minds. Jesus was resurrected. They could see him in front of them. They must have been overawed that Jesus had conquered death. They too, being his disciples, would have to conquer death, but they were not sure how. Here was Jesus standing at the other side of the divide. He was now in the spiritual realm. They were still in the temporal world. I remember once all the 5-year-old boys at school were lined up for inoculation. All of them were terrified. Then one boy came forward and stoically put out his hand and took the injection. As he walked back, the rest of the little boys looked at him in awe and admiration. He had crossed the bridge whilst they were still in trepidation at the thought. Well, the apostles are marveling at the sight and are now comforted by the confirmation of the resurrection. In front of them is the eternal resurrected Christ. In him, there is hope. They are fascinated that there is life after death in the spiritual world that Jesus so often professed when he said that his kingdom was not of this world. And when he said in Matthew chapter 16 verse 26, and what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? Sitting here with them, Jesus had truly showed them that the flesh amounted to nothing and that his kingdom was not of this world. They must have wondered if they too would ever have the courage to endure death and thereafter enjoy eternal life. They also must have been overawed by the fact that Jesus could not die a second time. They were still not filled with the Holy Spirit to understand these matters, so they dared not ask Jesus anything. If they dared to ask Jesus, "Who are you?" it would only show how daft they had been throughout the 3 years that he had trained them. We go to the next verse, verse 13. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. Throughout the stories of the resurrection appearances, it is in breaking bread with Jesus that the disciples recognize him, as was the case in Emmaus in the Gospel of Luke. Let's read the next part. Jesus reinstates Peter. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Now Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." You see, when we read these verses in English, everything is lost in translation. We miss the true meaning of what Jesus is intending to make Peter understand. To get to know the true meaning, we'll have to go into the original text of the above verses in Greek. Of course, we all know that this conversation took place in the Aramaic language but was written in Greek, because just like we Indians speak and write in English today because the British colonized us, so also Palestine had come under the Greek influence after the conquest of Alexander the Great and the colonization by the Romans. So how do we check out the meaning in Greek? You remember that in Bible Study 5, titled "The Secret to Interpreting Difficult Verses in the Bible," we had learned how to do that. Watch that video, yeah, if you've not watched it. By the way, you can watch any of my videos by typing in www.youtube.com/c/samsbibleclass. You know, the word "run" in English has 645 different meanings. You can Google it if you want. Similarly, the word "love" too has different meanings, but not in Greek. Each meaning has a separate word in Greek. Sorry. We will only look at some Greek words, a few of them: storge, philia and agape, all three of which translate into English as love. Let us take a look at what exactly storge means. It is a bond between family. It discriminates against those who are not family. It takes sides. Even wild animals and snakes love their little ones. Even the worst murderer will have immense love for his children. So there is nothing great about this love. Next we come to philia. What does philia mean? It is a bond between friends, just like the bond between family. It is a bond that shows a friend that he is special. But sadly, you will realize that it discriminates, takes sides. So there is nothing great either about this love. Lastly, we come to agape. What does agape mean? It is a love that is selfless and universal. It is how God loves us. He lets the sun shine on the good and the bad. He does not take sides nor discriminates. To give you a perfect example of the difference between philia and agape, let me tell you from personal experience. I have loved dogs all my life. I knew most of the dogs around by name. Then we bought a dog, a Labrador that we had, that was a golden ball of fur, only a few months old. We called him Abu. We took him to the vet to give him his shots for distemper and the like. When I was leaving, the vet advised me that I must make sure that he does not play with strays for the next 2 months till he has grown. The reason was that unlike the strays, Abu was pure breed. His immunity was thus not strong. We stay on the top floor, so every time Abu needed to poop, I would take him to the terrace and pick the poop and discard it. A few months later, when we took Abu for his follow-up to the vet, he told me that now since Abu was big and strong, I could take him around without fear. I remember the first time I took him to relieve himself. All the other dogs who seemed to be my friends, whom I loved very much, came charging towards Abu and snarling terrifyingly at him. At first, I tried to coax them away, but to no avail. They were now closing in on Abu to bite him. I could see Abu was confused. Then I started shooing them away, calling them out by name. Hey, Rani, shh, Moti, shh. You know, I was doing that. But the dogs just wouldn't budge. So I just stooped down and picked up a few stones. I intended to hit them till I suddenly realized that there was a time when I used to love them all. My agape love of the past, when I loved all the dogs without discrimination, was now gone. It had been replaced by filial love. That's what happens to us. We must learn to love as Jesus loved. He loved and forgave even his enemies on that cross. Now, having seen the meaning of those Greek words of philia and agape, let us read these verses again by replacing the word love by their Greek words as they occur in the original text, and you'll be surprised by what it means. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you agapao me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I phileo you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. See, you must remember that Jesus has chosen Peter to lead his flock. Peter would have been an ideal leader only if he had learned to universally love all people equally without any discrimination. Jesus is asking Peter whether he loves Jesus the way God loves everyone, equally, the agape way. But Peter thinks that Jesus is asking him if he loves him like he loves everyone else. Peter cannot imagine loving anyone as much as he loves Jesus. So he says, I love you in a special way, the philia way. Jesus understands Peter's nature, so he just commands Peter to feed his lambs. Jesus had chosen Peter not for what he was, but for what he could become. We go to the next part, 16, again with the Greek words for love. Again Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you agapao me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. He knows that Peter has not understood how Jesus expects him to love his flock the way God loves. So he asked Peter the same question a second time. But note how Jesus is giving a clue to Peter that he expects Peter to love his flock universally, whether they are lambs or whether they are sheep. Because in the first instance, he said, feed my lambs. And now he says, tend to my sheep. Now, lambs are young and sheep are old. Again, Peter, who is sort of stubborn in his thinking, says that he loves Jesus in a special way, the filial way. Jesus can be persistent, so Jesus tries a third time. I'm reading from verse 17. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you phileo me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you phileo me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I phileo you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. See, Jesus knows that a few weeks later, when the Holy Spirit comes down upon him, Peter will understand exactly what he meant. Our leaders in the church should remember this so that they love us all, the agape way, always, and without any discrimination between the rich and poor, or between races and between genders. So the third time Jesus speaks in Peter's tongue and asks him if he loves him the filia way. Jesus probably wanted Peter to understand what he was getting at, but Peter fails again. Instead, he feels hurt. He thinks Jesus is asking him the third time because he has denied Jesus thrice. We'll read from verse 18. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." See, Jesus is reminding Peter of the pitfalls of following him. He warns Peter about his persecution and death, which he would willingly accept to glorify God. Verse 20 and 21. When Peter turned and saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved was following them, this was the one who had leaned back against Jesus at the supper and said, "Lord, who is going to betray you?" When Peter saw him, he asked, "Lord, what about him?" Peter, ever the impulsive and caring leader that he is not worried about what Jesus warned him. Instead, he is worried about John, who is following them. Jesus answered, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me." Jesus is telling Peter that his job is not to worry. His job is only to follow him. If Peter just follows, Jesus will do the rest. We come to verse 23. Because of this, the rumor spread among the believers that this disciple would not die. But Jesus did not say that he would not die. He only said, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you?" You see, John was probably the oldest and only surviving apostle by the time this gospel was written, 70 years later. That is why there were rumors that John would never die, because Jesus had assured Peter. It is akin to WhatsApp rumors today. John is just brushing off those rumors. Verse 24. This is the disciple who testifies to these things and who wrote them down. We know that his testimony is true. You see, John, being a living apostle who lived with Jesus, is finally affirming the gospel as a truthful testimony. Verse 25. Jesus did many things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written. We have seen all the four Gospels, and yet we realize that it would be well nigh impossible to record every detail of every day in the life of Jesus. So if an incident is written in one Gospel but omitted in the others, do not jump to conclusions that it is not true and never occurred. It is finished. You know, I worked really hard to present John's Gospel, and I must thank the Holy Spirit, on whom I was consciously relying upon, for guiding me. A very big thank you to all of you viewers for watching. You know, I'll be starting the Gospel of Luke after a break of 3 months. Luke is such an enchanting Gospel with all its unique parables. Jesus was truly a master storyteller. His parables will make the Gospel of Luke very enjoyable. I hope and pray that the pandemic ends. But I'm noticing that as the pandemic recedes, the number of people watching these videos is also dwindling. I mean, the number of people watching these videos live. Those who have not watched my earlier videos can now watch whatever they have missed during the 3 months break. Please make sure that you pass on the link below to all your friends. Opening this link will open a page that displays all our videos. And that brings us to the end of chapter 21 of the Gospel of John. Let us summarize. In today's class, we studied the following. Jesus and the miraculous catch of fish. 2. We will see why the apostles dared not ask Jesus, "Who are you?" 3. Jesus tests Peter and reinstates him. So that's all, folks. That ends our Bible class. Do not forget to like, subscribe, share and comment. God bless. Praise God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.